Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Campbell. Thank you for the explain. The explanation is very interesting. We are continue to Q&A session. So there are questions from the participant. May I read or you want to read the question, Mr. Campbell?
I will try on the English.
Okay. From the
some is in English and some is in Indonesia. Maybe oh, yeah. I will translate for you. The one that maybe in Indonesia. Some of the question I already answer. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Polis. Thank you, Mr. Dwi.
Yeah. Maybe. Well, for SNI 075, Pak Amir Muklis, what local material can use for the trace track pavement in Mandalika GP Circuit? Saya sudah jawab, Pak, di pertanyaan sebelumnya. Jadi, kalau materialnya menggunakan material lokal untuk agregat dari Lombok, untuk yang base dan binder, tapi untuk yang surface, yang SMA surface, karena ada spesifikasi khusus ini, jadi ada namanya PSV, Polystone Value. Polystyrene value itu seperti kelekatan aspal, tapi dibandingkan dengan kalau dia kena ban terus gitu. Nah ini PSV ini yang di Lombok itu abrasinya nggak masuk, jadi abrasinya terlalu besar. Jadi Los Angeles value-nya itu terlalu besar, batasannya itu harus di bawah 20. Nah batu Lombok sudah kita coba hampir 5 quarry yang kita kirim ke UK, itu nggak masuk PSV-nya. Nah, kita coba kirim dari Bali, kita coba kirim dari Lampung dan dari Palu. Itu yang masuk yang dari Palu. Jadi Palu abrasinya, Palu pun ada 3 quarry yang kita kirim. 2 quarry nggak masuk. Abrasinya di bawah 20 tapi PSV-nya justru malah terlalu tinggi. Ini nggak boleh tinggi malah PSV-nya. Itu PSV-nya harus rendah. Jadi dia bisa menyerap aspal tapi kelekatan kepada ban juga cukup gitu. Nah, ini yang agak sulit di situ. Alhamdulillah dari Palu kita dapat tuh, jadi sumber materialnya dari namanya PT Palu Madu Batu, itu yang sudah masuk PSV-nya yang dites di UK. Terus yang kedua, how to adopt race track pavement technology for other circuit in Indonesia. Ya paling tidak di surface-nya. Jadi kayak Sentul ya harusnya di surface-nya yang di seperti di Silverstone itu di cold milling ya, setelah itu dilakukan servis ulang. Cuma permasalahan di Silverstone ini, permasalahan di Sentul ini karena sekarang motor semakin cepat ya, khusus MotoGP. Yang dulu waktu kita tahun 96-97 ada di Indonesia, itu masih CC-nya masih 125, 250, dan 500. Sekarang CC-nya sudah 250, 500, dan 1000. Nah, sehingga kecepatannya semakin cepat, sehingga kebutuhan run off baik itu gravel maupun aspal, baik khususnya gravel ya, itu jadi cukup besar. Di Mandalika ada dua turn yang cukup besar gravelnya, itu yang pertama di turn 1. Turn 1 dari trek lurus itu dia butuh hampir sekitar 100 meter dari tepi aspal sampai ke ujung service route. Untuk di tikungan 10, karena itu top speednya bisa sampai 310 km per jam, itu hampir 180 meter. Gravelnya. Nah ini mungkin yang Sentul agak kesulitan mendapatkan lahan untuk bisa memperluas gravel tersebut. Gitu. Jadi kalau untuk pavementnya, teknologinya mungkin hanya tinggal cold milling dan di surface ulang gitu ya. Yang ketiga, how to solve bump problem on the track surface. Kalau sudah jadi bump harus dipotong, Pak. Kalau sudah jadi bump ya. Tapi kalau belum ya kita coba memaksimalkan supaya jangan terjadi bump gitu. Jadi makanya,
don't have any bumps to begin with, Jui.
Sorry?
Don't have any bumps to begin with, Jui. That's the answer, isn't it?
Yeah. So, it need to be removed, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's a problem in itself. It's a difficult challenge. Sorry.
Yeah. Terus untuk SNI 527, izin bertanya, because the circuit is on the seaside, how to solve the wind that contain water spray from the sea and the sand particle that will be entering to the track while it race. and how strong is the Fata Morgana, the mirror effect on the asphalt, and how many spot on the mirror on the asphalt, and what is the effect of the salt water to the track? Maybe you can help to answer that, Campbell.
Yeah, sure. So in terms of water spray during the race, that's unlikely because of the position of the barriers and the fences that will be used. It would have to be very, very high winds for there to be water spray onto the track itself. That would be enough to damage or affect the riders, and they wouldn't race in those conditions. In terms of sand blowing onto the track, that could be a problem. Not so much for safety, but more for the TV spectacle. And this happened in Singapore, actually, at the Singapore Grand Prix. They had a lot, and it happens in the Middle East, obviously, because they're in the desert. They have a lot of sand sitting on the surface. And then when the bikes or the cars race and they go from the start grid, you get this dust cloud coming up, and it looks really bad on television. So the way to mitigate against that and stop it happening is to treat the surface before each race using high-pressure water. So high-pressure water retexturing to clean the track surface, and that will solve the most of the problems with the sand. In terms of issues with salt, it shouldn't be a major problem. It will obviously help corrode anything that's around, but again, good track preparation before the race events, so track cleaning, and good maintenance will prevent against and mitigate against these potential issues. I hope that answered
okay,
the question.
Thank you. Maybe the next question is from SNE 541 by Cristianto. With this high standard construction requirement for the racetrack, what is the span duration for construction lifetime? What is the requirement for repair in the case at the future occur some crack or problem on the surface of the racetrack? Is it allowed to do partially patching?
Okay, I can answer that. So the lifespan design of the racetrack is 10 to 15 years. So our remit was to design the race for the racetrack for the life of the contract with MotoGP, which I think is 5 years. But we would expect it to last 10 years. But that big part of that is going to come down to how the track surface is used. So with it being partially a road, that means it will get more wear, and that will come down to the type of vehicles that are using the track. If it's just light vehicles like scooters and motorbikes, then it probably won't be too bad. If there's heavy goods vehicles, trucks and lorries, then that wear could be exacerbated and become worse, because what we don't want to happen is rutting. If we start to get wheel tracks and rutting, then the motorbikes in particular are very, very sensitive to this. And FIM or Dorna will tell NGPA that the track has to be resurfaced again. So that's going to be a big problem. We are trying to mitigate against that happening by using an SNA, so the stone mastic asphalt, which doesn't rut as in the same way that an asphalt concrete would, for example. In terms of requirements for repair, if there's cracking or problems with the surface track, well, there is likely to be subsidence and movement, which might cause damage to the track, purely because of the site conditions and where the site's located. And it's obviously natural, it will happen. So there will have to be repairs over time. So if there's cracks start to appear, then the trick is to carry out remedial work as fast as possible. So try to repair it where we can. So using overband sealing crack repairs, that's fine. If it gets very bad, then sections will have to be planed out and reinstatement patches put back in. Again, even we could get damage from a rider coming off a bike or accident. It happens all the time. It happened in Silverstone. First race that happened, went out there, somebody went down on a bike and the peg went through the track and ripped a gouge out of the track. So they had to put a patch in. It will happen, and it is allowed. It can be used. It just the material for the patches has to be to the same specification as the racetrack surface, and it has to be very carefully designed and planed out, very carefully. Same when it comes to other bigger remedial works and patches. Ideally, you don't want to just do a small section. You'd want to do the entire width of the track and take a longer section out. And particularly if it's in high stress zones, such as braking zones, the apex of corners, you want to take out, rather than just a 10 meter section, you'd be looking to do a 100 to 500 meter section.
Okay, thank you, Campbell. On the top, I said to them that for Mandalika circuit, because it's an open street circuit, so I reduce the lifetime from your specification 10 to 15, I reduce to 8 to 10.
Yeah.
Just a clarification.
Thanks.
because we love to have it 10 to 15 years, but the plan is to have the street circuit, so we reduce the lifetime for our internal purpose to prepare the budget and everything to be 8 to 10 years.
Just very, very sensible.
To all. we are not pessimistic, but we are conservative.
No, absolutely. Anything you get longer is a bonus.
Yes, thank you. So the next one is you said that.
Kita masih punya sisa waktu 5 menit lagi, Pak.
Oh yeah, okay, Pak.
Atau 2 pertanyaan.
Yeah, the next question. Yeah,
kasih,
the next question is maybe the most question that from all the audience is the why using SMA, not using the asphalt concrete wearing course. You generally already explained that. Maybe you can explain more detailing, maybe about the stone to stone contact and everything.
Sure. So so using an asphalt concrete for the wearing course, the surface course, is used all around the world. It was used in Silverstone, Singapore, Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur, which is fine. It's commonly used in Indonesia for roads, I believe, and airports. The difference between asphalt wearing and asphalt concrete and SMA in terms of a racetrack is in order to achieve the levels of macro texture that we are looking for on Mandalika, it's an SMA is more likely to achieve that. Also, SMAs don't rot, whereas asphalt concretes do, which, as this is a street circuit, and because motorbikes are more susceptible to bumps, it's less likely to deform in that way. In terms of tire surface interaction, an SMA will produce generally a smoother surface, and a flatter surface, which will increase the tire surface interaction and the number of aggregate points that are in contact with the tire, which will give higher levels of grip. So these are the main reasons that MGPA and PPA have chosen to go with the SMA rather than asphalt concrete. The two options that were considered were a 10 millimeter SMA and a 12.5 millimeter asphalt concrete. But currently we're looking to use the 10 millimeter SMA for those reasons.
Which is quite hard for us.
Yeah.
But we try our best. Yeah, the last one is about, maybe I will answer Indonesia ya, about the local content. Jadi untuk TKDN, ya Bapak Ibu, untuk TKDN yang ada di sini, material impor itu hanya 3. Jadi yang diimpor itu adalah aspal untuk surface. Jadi aspal surface-nya aja yang menggunakan sel Sarifarte Aspatrek PG82 grade PG82. Yang kedua adalah Haroton drainase, dan yang ketiga adalah pagar. Pagar untuk pagarnya pun juga concrete barrier-nya itu cornya di Indonesia. Jadi kalau secara nominal itu tidak lebih dari 20%. Jadi dari total kontrak 900 miliar itu hanya 170-an miliar material yang kita impor, sisanya itu menggunakan produk dalam negeri, khususnya untuk batu, subbase, dan aspal PEN 60-70 juga menggunakan produk Pertamina. Mungkin itu Pak Kholis yang bisa kami sampaikan dari saya dan Mr. Campbell. Terima kasih atas waktunya. Saya kembalikan ke Pak Kholis. Thank you, Campbell.
Thank you, Dwi. Thank you, everybody. Very nice to meet you all. Thank you for having me.
Terima kasih, Pak Dwi. Thank you very much.